Well, welcome back, everyone. We've now got another discussion on continuing on the theme of this morning, and it's a panel discussion, which will each of the panel speakers will speak, and then there'll be questions. But my job is really just to introduce Julie Coggan, who's the is going to chair this session. Julie is the deputy dean at the Australian School of Business, and she's a also a responsibility within that role for engagement. And her research area is very much around this topic area of international people management, high-performing workplaces, and human resource management. One particular stream of her work that's, I think, quite relevant for today is work looking at, cross generations and looking at age-related conflict in the workplace, and a focus on how organisations can configure a workplace to optimise the ability for, you know, people in different age groups to work effectively together. So I think that's a great set of skills to bring to the already illustrious panel. So I'll hand over to you, Julie. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. So this morning, George and John discussed age-friendly practices and the pressures on government, business, and societies. So I really enjoyed the example that John provided. It struck me of the 60-year-old employee who required flexibility to respond and to assume elder care responsibilities of their 85-year-old parent. I was also reminded as he went through that example that policies alone do not account for the organisational culture and the norms of behaviour which inhibit take-up of these policies. It was great to get George along this morning to outline how Medibank is really transforming their businesses and putting some initiatives in place that recognise the ageing population. So this morning, we have a diverse panel coming from finance, insurance, and public policy that are going to discuss how government and business should respond to some of these issues. So I'm delighted to welcome our first presenter, and we're going to run the presenters up sequentially, four back-to-back, and then questions and discussions at the end of the session. But to welcome Paul Clitheroe, thank you for coming, Paul. Paul is the director at ipac Securities and also is the chairperson of the Australian Government Financial Literacy Board. You probably know him, you've seen him on TV, maybe heard him on the radio or read one of his books. He's absolutely committed to improving the financial skills of all Australians. And in fact, he starts with young people and he gets into schools and talks to children, so it's a what better place to start. So would you please welcome Paul.
Thanks for that, and nice to be back at my old university. Along with Bob over here. Bob was at Basser College and I was at Baxter College, 1974 to 1976, Bob. So it's though mind you, most of these buildings weren't here, speaking of an ageing and things changing. Now, I just want to spend my just a bit over 10 minutes with you, just having a little natter about some of the issues from really from my government hat. So I chair financial literacy. John Howard asked me to do that, about a decade ago, when we established the first national strategy for financial literacy. And if you're wondering why we're doing that, and I do get a lot of questions about this, because it really fits firmly into our agenda today. Because I do get many people saying, oh, for heaven's sake, isn't that mum and dad's job? You know, why have teachers got to teach financial literacy? We've now got 92 money smart schools, and we've got some 8,000 teachers trained in delivering financial literacy in the schooling system. We've got it built into the national curriculum from kindergarten to year 10. It's taught in English, maths, and so on. And you're saying, why the heck would you teach financial literacy in English? Well, that's mainly because the geniuses, including myself in my industry, invented a bunch of words which made money an entire new language. And this is one of the challenges to ageing. We've created a money language. So how is our ageing population going to cope with some of this? I loved one of the phone calls I had, which I thought was a great example, quite a number of years ago, just after the GFC, when a very despondent independent retiree rang me on, I think it was 2UE, and said, Paul, I'm in this superannuation product called Capital Stable, which has just fallen 30%. Yeah, it's kind of interesting, isn't it? Yeah, I'm not sure whether to laugh or cry. I mean, which bleeding idiot invented the words for which Heather and myself would be strongly in favour of, salary sacrifice into superannuation? Now, being financially literate and English trained, we speak a language called money in this room, or you probably wouldn't be here. And so we think salary sacrifice, yes, you know, fantastic. You know, we pay 15% tax, we top up our super, we put in 25 grand, isn't it marvellous, blah, 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 blah. Out there in the real world, you know what salary sacrifice really means? That salary sacrifice is when the boss comes in and says things are tough, there's no overtime this weekend. Salary sacrifice. Ludicrous. So anyway, there's a range of challenges in financial literacy, and the biggest of all, of course, is when Bob and myself were here at uni, and Heather was at Women's College at Sydney Uni, and we were laughing about allowances back then, and I used to pull beers down at the Regent Hotel down in Anzac Parade down there for $33 a week, which, by the way, was pretty good money, because a schooner of beer in those days was 33 cents, so $33 a week was a 99 schooner lifestyle, which is just about right. Now, what is really quite challenging, about all this is that, in a sense, is that, and this is really, if you like, government-friendly response to ageing, is that it's not recognising you can't just leave people out there. We've got two solutions to this area. ASIC regulates. I run financial literacy alongside Greg Medcraft, the chairman of ASIC, and if you like, I'm responsible for the education side of money, the knowledge side of money. Money skills, financial literacy, call it what you like. And regulation and education sit side by side, which is why we're going right back to school days. But back to my fundamental point, why are we even teaching this stuff? Well, when Bob, Heather and myself were at uni, at either Sydney or here, with our small allowances, we actually didn't need any money skills because you couldn't get into trouble. You just couldn't get into trouble. Basically, if I ran out of money at the pub on a Friday night, what did I do in 1974? Went home. No ATM. Bank card first came out in 1980. There was a diner's card and an Amex card around in those days. Weren't inclined to give it to 18-year-old uni students earning $33 pulling beers. So basically, the advantage for me was there was no credit available to me. You know, we've all had these meetings, move on a few years. I get married to Vicky some 30-odd years ago. We go for our first meeting. I'm starting my business IPAC. Our National Australia Bank, who is still my bank, amazingly enough, says, look, Paul, you're starting a business, you've got bugger all income. I say, that's true. And Vicky says, oh, yes, but I'm a school teacher, I'm on a good income, you know, we're a good risk for a loan. And bank manager says, madam, you'll be pregnant any day, both of you bugger off. Now, basically it. My wife is still outraged, by the way. So it is really quite interesting, though, that why are we improving people's money skills? Because as a community, we have to. We have to. That is a government response, if you like, and both the sort of work that the Heather and Australian Super, the super funds are doing, the industry funds, the retail funds, and bluntly, even our major banks are doing a lot of good work in the area of giving people better money skills, credit unions. Sometimes we need to beat them around the head a bit, and this is where at times regulation's better than education. I'm interested in your views. Where we're struggling with money skills is we've got no doubt, and we can show you this in our longitudinal surveys, there's no doubt that the awareness of being better with money is improving. The awareness of long life is improving. The awareness that not only are we living longer, we're living more expensively. Our choices are far more interesting. This is not a problem. Our choices are really far more interesting. You know, used to retire, basically do a language course at TAFE. Retire, do a cooking course at TAFE. What do I think about retiring, doing a cooking course in France? Lot better. Lot more expensive, lot better. We're living extremely well. These are real challenges for policymakers, and often our leaders in politics don't really want to talk about a lot of this stuff, because the reality is that I am not depressed about the challenges of ageing. I'm excited about the challenges of ageing. Last night, to do a bit of research for this, I went to the death clock, and I like the death clock, and I put in my most recent blood test, and the death clock once again put me as living to 91 with an asterisk. And the asterisk wasn't that I'd run out of money. The asterisk was, please be careful. The way medicine's going, you may live longer. Don't base your money around 91. Now, I'm not going to get terribly depressed about that. But I understand the challenge at a personal level, at a superannuation fund level, at a community level, banks, building societies, credit unions, academics, universities, and, of course, government. So the thing that really, of course, is challenging for me in terms of trying to be friendly towards all these issues in a government sense is, yes, you try and bring better regulation. And where regulation works better is I'm convinced that people had the knowledge some years ago that when you went to an ATM, if it was a foreign ATM, you were going to pay a couple of bucks. I think people kind of got that. but we got no behavioural change, we got no bite. And this is where regulation was better, when the banks were required to put, press this button to pay us $2. We knew we were paying $2, but the fact we had to press the button to give to donate $2 to the bank caused behavioural change. We're trying that now with the new credit card statements in the credit code from starting July 1. You'll notice on your credit card, we notice with fascination that Australians my age get a credit card bill and they go, ah, damn, I owe $2,000. What we find fascinating is people under 35 go, oh, not too bad. On the same account balance, they go, I owe $90. Because they only look at the minimum repayment box. Whereas I'm old, I'm a dinosaur, I look at what I owe. And that's why in the minimum repayment box you're now finding it says, and if you pay the minimum repayment and don't use the card again, for most cards it'll take about 32 years to pay it back. And we're trying, oh, some cards, by the way, go as high as 64 years. But we are trying to get those messages out because we want people, we want, and that we cannot do. You know, we know people know credit cards are expensive. How do we get them to change their behaviour? If we move to age, I would personally, and others in the room will disagree, and I love a bit of disagreement, that's fantastic. I would personally, if I was a dictator, I would ban the word retirement. It is a stupid word. We only invented it 100 years ago. I am very happy for Australians to retire, but we cannot retire longer and live more expensively. You know, I think look, I'm glad I'm not a politician. Now, the Paul Clitheroe world of politics would say, vote for the Clitheroe party. Basically, we either need to raise more money, and I like higher GST, I like death tax, I like all sorts of logical things to generate more money, and then we can spend more money. If we're not going to spend more money, and I want to stop work, if I want to stop work now, like most Australians, I've got a simple choice. I can basically live more cheaply, in which case I think I can afford to stop. Or if I want to live expensively, which at the moment is my preference, I need to keep earning money. But we need to get these messages out there. I'm glad I'm not a politician doing that. Guess what, folks? I want you to work longer. I want you to pay more tax, higher GST and death duties. Vote for me. It's just an absolute stroke of political genius. And that's why groups like this will take the leadership situation in a really difficult but really positive story. It is about living. Let's please not ever forget, we are talking about living longer. Oh, the problems with dementia. Willing to take the risk. The other choice is die. Happy to take a punt, okay? Happy to take a punt. Let's not get too whingy about this. Oh, we're living longer. Oh, the problems. Oh, for God's sake, grow up. Look, this is wonderful, okay? This is really, really good. How we deal with it is really, really challenging. And I do not think we can count on our political leaders to be giving the sort of messages that probably need to be put out there. Where did our pension system come from? I was down doing a thing with pensioners in Adelaide recently, the leaders of that particular group of people, and they had a perfectly legitimate set of complaints. Age pension's not enough. I agree. They turned up with budgets and stuff to put up on the PowerPoint screens. I agree. Yes. But during question time, I said, look, out of curiosity, I'll ask you a question. When did the age pension system start? And of course, no one knew. And I said, look, it started in 1908. And they went, oh, did it? And I said, now, 1908, when our forebears started the age pension system, why did they choose a male age of 65? And the group said, because we died at 65, you fool. And I said, no, we didn't. We died at 54 back in 1908. Our forebears chose a retirement pension system to start 11 years after your average rate of death. And that'd be another great Paul Clitheroe political promise. Males are meant to live to 79. You can have an age pension at 90. You can really see I'm on a vote winner here. I might join the Palmer Party. I could help him no end. But we all know these to be realities. We're not going to argue about realities. You know, none of us. We're all from, you know, we understand the great research CEPAR does, the work that all sorts of people are doing. I actually think our challenge in so many ways is actually a challenge of communication. Because in a sense, and I know I'm playing with statistics here, because obviously if we go back to 1908, when I talk about males dying at 54, obviously those males were born in the 1850s, so I'm playing with numbers here a little bit. But I like to tease people by saying, well, gee, you know, look, really, compared to someone back in 1908 who's dying at 54, and I know I'm playing with numbers here, but basically, you know, hey, you know, we're talking about living maybe 25 years longer. And that's, you know, really, really, really fantastic. Why, as a community of people, we've decided that while we're living longer and we're living more expensively, here's a great idea, we'll stop work earlier. Genius. So for me, I think the numbers, and I'll finish on this point, I think the numbers are really simple. We know the numbers. I'm excited about the numbers. The one thing I do love on my asterisk on the death clock, and I do notice in Hazel Bateman's research and Leonie Tickle's research, I do notice, I do read this with great interest, by the way, and I did see a recent paper, I think the two of those worked on jointly, which is actually saying the only thing the folk in demographics have got wrong is they've been consistently pessimistic, and that is we've always lived longer than predicted. So let's not go, oh, the 91 thing, ah, no, Paul, you'll drop dead tomorrow. I could. But on the other hand, what if Karl Krasnowski is correct, and Karl says that maybe most of us in this room are the last group of human beings who do not have to choose their date of death? Now, that's really challenging, isn't it? Let me put it to you, the challenge is an exciting one. There are many, many bad parts in it. My part in it is attempting to continue as much as I can. This is with my pro bono time, by the way. I'm trying to use my pro bono time through things like Money Smart Week later this year, through financial literacy, through schools and universities, by being here today. If I have a tiny part to play in this, it's just getting people to say, I am lucky to be alive. I am lucky to have a chance of living longer. It's incumbent on me to participate in the decisions to allow me to live longer in a way that I want to live. So my big point here today is not the facts. It's facts, evidence, I think, are hard to argue against. I'm really interested between us, and if anyone can help me, please ring or email me, I'm easy to find. I'm really interested in how do we communicate that and take awareness of these issues into actual behavioural change. That's the bit I'm most interested in. So thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Paul. We'll do questions at the end. Our next speaker, Bob Cumming, is a professor of epidemiology and geriatric medicine and a chief investigation at CEPAR. Bob researches about older people and in Australia and also developing countries such as Africa. So please welcome Bob.
Well, gosh, that's a hard act to follow. So I'm a professor in a medical school, so I can't speak without PowerPoint slides. And there they are. Yes, I was here at the University of New South Wales at the same time as Paul. And I actually went to medical school at the same time as John Beard, and I first met John in 1978 as a medical student in Darwin on an elective term. And there'd be lots of stories of that time I could tell, but I won't. So I'm going to talk from three different perspectives. I'm going to talk about health, because my background is in medicine, and there will be some overlap with what John said, but I think that's fine. I'm going to talk a little bit about demography, which is what population ageing is all about, obviously, and also a little bit of a global perspective, particularly because of my relatively new interest in ageing in developing countries, which I guess, although I haven't retrained, like a lot of people in the future, in their 50s, people will move in a new direction. So just with health, this is a graph from the Global Burden of Disease study that was published in The Lancet just before Christmas. So a really important series of papers on health in the world. And then from that, you can then go to the website, which is up there, and get some nice graphics. Don't worry too much about the different colours. What I put this here for is really to show the health of the Australian population. And if we take death as, I guess, a good proxy measure of health, Australians don't start dying until they're in the 40s and 50s, and most Australians will die in their late 70s or after they turn 80. So if this was a picture of East Africa, it would look quite different. But in Australia, children are healthy, middle-aged adults are healthy, and even people my age and older, still, death rates are pretty low, and it's really only among people in their 80s that deaths start happening. If you look at the obituaries in the Sydney Morning Herald, which I've started to do, maybe I'm a bit young to do that, but it's fascinating. I love their life histories, but also nearly all of them are in their 80s. If you see someone in their 70s, you think, gosh, that was young. My point with this slide is to suggest that older workers in their 50s and 60s will generally be healthy. The health problem for older workers is their older parents. And that's been mentioned a couple of times, that if you're a 55-year-old, your parents are going to be in that 80-year-old age group, and they're going to be seeing doctors a lot, they're going to be sick, they might be thinking about transitions into different types of housing, and it's their children in their 50s and 60s that are going to have to help them make those decisions, take them to see doctors and so on. So this has been mentioned a couple of times, but businesses need to be able to give their workers in their 50s and 60s time off to help their ageing parents even just go to doctor's appointments. And as we heard from George, older people tend to have a doctor for every different organ. So there are a lot of specialist medical appointments that older people need to keep. This is another graphic from that same report. This is looking at the sort of health problems that people have while they're alive. Not necessarily the things that kill them, but the things that might interfere with their ability to work when they're age 50 to 69. Each of these, the area of each of these boxes is proportional to the amount of poor health that is caused by these problems. And the biggest box is low back pain, which is something we don't talk about much. There's very little research done on back pain. And the box MDD up the top is depression. But if we just look at, all these are musculoskeletal problems. So low back pain, neck pain, osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, other musculoskeletal diseases we don't have nice names for. And this is really a vastly neglected area of research and really something that government should be putting a lot more money into. And obviously for workers that have to do physical work, this is a huge problem for them to continue working. When we talk about people working into their 60s and 70s, we're thinking about people who are sitting at a desk thinking. If you actually have to do physical work, these things are going to stop you working into your 60s even. So that's 50 to 69-year-olds, workers. And this is in rich countries like Australia, the US, and so on. We're now moving on to the age of those people's parents. And the big one here, and it's been mentioned a little bit this morning, is dementia, Alzheimer's disease. And this is another area that we really need to do a lot more work on, both in terms of medical research, healthcare research, and so on. Although Alzheimer's in the last 20 years now has a profile and does get reasonable research funding. All right, I wanted to talk about this concept of compression of morbidity, which is a concept about 30 years old. When the concept was first mooted by Jim Freese from Stanford, the theory was that people had a natural life expectancy, which might be, say, 90. In this slide, it's 76. But the idea was that people couldn't live beyond 90. There'd be a few exceptions, but most people would, even if they remained in perfect health until they were 80, 85, they would drop dead at 90. Now, we now know that's wrong, that life expectancy keeps going up and up and up and up. But the theory of compression of morbidity is that we're all going to die at 90. Hopefully, we won't get sick until we're 89, and we'll have a year of poor health, and then we'll die in our sleep. And I think that's what we'd all like. Of course, that's not the case. If we just look at the top graphic here, it suggests that we might start getting unwell at 55, and we die at 76. So we have 21 years of poor health. If life expectancy goes up, which of course it has, up to 80, and we still start getting sick at 55, then we now live with 25 years of poor health. So that's an extension, if you like, of morbidity. Or what might happen is that our life expectancy goes up to 81, and we also delay the onset of poor health to 60, and we live 21 years with poor health. Or the ideal situation is the bottom example here, where we delay the onset of poor health until we're 65, we die at 78, and we only have 13 years of poor health. Unfortunately, we still don't know which one of these scenarios is accurate. We really don't have good data on whether or not the bottom one is happening, the compression of morbidity, We really don't know whether the compression of morbidity is happening, which we'd really like, delaying the onset of poor health and then dying in our sleep at a certain age, or whether we're in the life extension thing where onset of morbidity is at the same age as it always was, but we're living longer with morbidity. We really don't have good data on this. And it's something, again, that I think we should be putting a lot more investment into working out. Because if, in fact, there is a compression of morbidity, yes, then we can keep working until we're older or enjoying life until we're older. If, on the other hand, being unwell is going to continue starting at the same sort of age, we're simply going to have a much longer period when we're unwell, which will cost a lot, we can't enjoy life, and we can't continue working. So this is something that really needs 30 years, and we still don't really know the answer. Eileen Crimmins, who was here earlier in the week, who I don't think is here this morning, is one of the world experts on this topic. Okay, so compression and morbidity and delaying death could be due to improved lifestyle. So if we stop smoking, we'll have our heart attack at a much older age, and we'll go into heart failure at an older age, and we'll probably die at an older age. There's also improved healthcare. So with good healthcare, management of hypertension and so on, we have our stroke at an older age. Medical care keeps us alive for a bit longer, but we still die. One area that hasn't been talked about much, and I owe these examples to a colleague of mine, Len Smith, that I talked to in Seoul. I was in Seoul last week as well. Improved technology, and I'm not talking about medical technology here. I'm talking about the whole technology industry outside medicine, where costs are going down. And we were talking about dementia and the lack of progress with drugs to treat dementia. And Len and I were talking about this, the idea of Google goggles. So this idea that you've got glasses connected to a computer and it gives you little messages on the inside of your glasses. For example, I don't know how many of you have trouble finding your car these days in a car park. I have started actually writing on my hand where my car is parked. Not always, only in complicated car parks. I know I'm on the third floor over here and I'll find my car easily. But you could look at your car and say, remember where my car is, and then your goggles will take you back to your car. And at an older age, when you have dementia and you're wandering and you might get lost, your computer knows where you live, and when you're out feeling a bit lost, it'll give you directions home. So although you will still have dementia, the disability associated with dementia will be reduced. A smart car. So a car that takes, you get in the car and say, take me home, or take me to the shops. So you don't have to worry about your neck arthritis that means you can't look anywhere anymore and therefore can't drive. You have a car that takes you. So this sort of technology for overcoming disability, not the basic health problem that you have, but actually overcoming the disability of the health problem, could transform the way very old people live. Okay, I just want to end up by saying a little bit of demography. John started off with demography. And as I say, that's really driving why we're here. This is China in 2050. Not that far away, really, 35 years from now. It's certainly not a population pyramid, although these things are still called population pyramids. You know, in China in 2050, there are going to be a lot more people, nearly twice as many people aged 60 to 64 as there are little children. A very old population with a reducing number of workers, people aged 20 to 55, 60. And this ageing of China is something that's being talked about more and more. I heard something on the radio just a couple of days ago. So the economic impact of this for China with a reducing workforce is huge. So that's China. This is Australia. Very different. China, by the way, is very similar to Korea, Japan, Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong. Australia has a much more healthy looking population. A lot more older people, but still a lot of people in the productive period of life. So really, if we think we've got a problem, it ain't nothing compared to many other countries in the world. And in fact, we should take advantage of our population structure. Now, I'm going to finish with my favourite area of the world in this time of my life. This is a large country in Africa, Ethiopia. This is 2050 in Africa. Still got a population pyramid. Still lots of young children, lots of people of working age, and lots of older people. And I guess in the second half of this century, I'm suggesting, and being a bit provocative here, that maybe Africa is going to be the place where all the workers come from and where all the production is happening. It's a fair way off, but it's within my lifetime. I'll be alive in 2050, I'm confident. I'm going to make it to 100. But certainly in our children's lifetime, Africa is somewhere we need to think about. So just in summary, in regards to health, 50 and 60-year-olds are generally healthy, but they need a workplace that enables them to care for their unhealthy older parents. Demographically, Australia's demographic dividend, that is the large number of working age people that we have, is going to last a lot longer than China's and most of East Asia, and so Australia is well positioned. And perhaps the second half of the 21st century may well become Africa's century. So thank you.
Thanks very much, Bob. Our next speaker, Heather Ridout, is on the board of the Reserve Bank, chairperson of Australian Superannuation, and director of Sims Metal Management, as well as holding other board positions which are listed in her bio in the materials. Heather has an impressive history of leading public policy change. For example, she was a member of the Henry Tax Review and participated on the Round Table for Climate Change. Please welcome Heather.
Thanks very much, Julie, for that very kind introduction. And it's lovely to be here. And I really want to congratulate John Piggott and Mark for this centre and how it's evolved. I think, Professor Piggott, when we were sitting around that 18 months on Henry, this was the sparkle in the eye. And look at it now. It's just amazing. And it's such a worthwhile public policy endeavour. And I think the great thing, I was meeting one of your Chinese counterparts who introduced me to her this morning, and it is a global issue, demography, and it's fantastic that this university is reaching out so solidly to other countries, including those, and particularly those in our region. So congratulations, and it's a very important. I guess given my background, I didn't know how to come at this issue. You know, I come at it from a public policy perspective. I come at it as with a big interest in superannuation. Australian Super's got 2.2 million people, $65 billion under management, big deal. And I also come at it as a former leader of a big employer organisation and who's sort of wrung their hands about this issue for a number of years. So it was very difficult to figure out what I was going to say because there's so many things to say. But, you know, I'll kind of start with Henry, with the public policy recognition that when we were doing that report, John and I and Ken Henry and Jeff Harmer and Greg Smith, we sat down and developed the four or five drivers of what was going to have to be the framework in which the new tax system that we were trying to put together conceptually was going to have to exist in. And of course, globalisation, technology, environment, and ongoing population and ageing. And they were it. And it seems to be the basic, one of the basic drivers of the whole framework. I think the challenge is well known. We've, I think George took us through the dependency ratios and how they're rising from 5 to 2.7, or falling, or rising, however you want to think about it. But I think one of the issues is where we're really at on it. And I think, you know, this issue, the fact that only 68% of men and 50% of women between the age of 45 and 64 are employed, which translates to a participation rate for that group of about 58%, well below comparable countries like the US, UK, Canada, New Zealand. These are worrying figures. And frankly, there's not much likelihood of it improving because, according to the ABS, the average retirement age for those who had retired in the last 5 years was 61.4. And moreover, the average age at which people aged 45 and over currently in the workforce intend to retire is just 62.9, 4 years short of the eligible age for the age pension. Or some of these will be 65, some will be 67, depending on how old they are in this cohort. But you can see there, people are retiring well before the official retirement age. And of course then, as we've heard over and over again, they're going to face upwards of 20 years in retirement. But the difficult thing is, many of these people don't have the funds to retire. According to ASFA, the average super balance upon retirement age, people aged 60 to 64 is just $192,000 for men and $112,000 for women. So it falls well short of the comfortable age. It's interesting. 80%, I think, of people, if I recall that Henry study right, end up on a whole or part age pension. But particularly when the preservation age and the pension age are quite separate, you can end up using up your bit of super and you'll end up completely on the old age pension and you'll need to be there for a long time. Or you'll need to return to work. Now, there's 228,000 people who have retired who now want to return to work, and it's mainly for financial reasons because they're running out of money. And that issue, when you think of it, we've only got about 600,000 unemployed people in Australia. That's a huge number who are outside of it wanting to come back. if people retire before the age of 65, they're clearly missing out on hugely important productive years, and if they work another 5 to 10 years, even part-time, can mean thousands of dollars more at retirement. According to MoneySmart, for a 45-year-old worker now earning $80,000 with a current super account of $100,000, retiring at 67 instead of 62, that's 5 more years, will add an extra 28% in retirement savings. And that's not including putting extra money in or using a transition to retirement scheme. The final outcome for that person, $408,000, is virtually spot on with the ASFA standard retirement level for comfortable retirement, which is about $430,000. So 5 years can be quite transformative in terms of your decision about whether and about how well off you will be in retirement. This goes, of course, to the issue of education. And I think financial literacy is a very, very important thing, but I think we do need to drum into people the choices they're making and how informed they need to be about it. Some of the financial advice has not covered the industry in glory over recent years, and there's a lot more regulation around that issue. But I do believe people need to understand the choice they make, and they are making it. They are intending to make it in huge numbers, which will really deprive them of important retirement savings. So I think that's a big lesson we need to learn. Also, they need to realise the value of that, that super nest egg. 192 months sound a lot for most people, and frankly it is at the moment. When you retire often, the balances are much smaller than that. But AustralianSuper has a pension plus arrangement that we can, with a $50,000 nest egg, we can give people $150 a week extra on top of their old age pension of $330 a week for 20 years as a pension product. But this is not being taken up very much because people say, oh, I've got $50,000, I'm going to buy a boat, or I'm going to do this with it or that with it. They don't realise the value of the little nest egg they have, however small it might be. $150 on top of $330 a week is a really important thing. So these are all these issues around of financial literacy that Paul spoke so eloquently about. I think we also need to do a bit of work about our attitudes to ageing. I think this is a very, ageing's a very loaded term, and Susan Ryan, who unfortunately couldn't be here, she's done some really interesting work around this. Young Australians and older Australians define old age differently. Younger Australians, the meaning of old age, the mean age of old age, the mean age of old age, is 55.9. How incredibly insulting compared to we older Australians who think that we don't think old age starts to 66.9. I think that's even a bit low. And when you're elderly, young people think you're elderly at 66.7, and for older people think it starts closer to 75. So there's huge gap. Most Australians feel that age discrimination is common in Australia. 74% of all Australians feel age discrimination is common. For findings for the business respondents to her work say at 71%, so much the same. Most community and business respondents felt that discrimination is likely to occur in the workplace. 88% of community respondents and 92% of business respondents believe there's discrimination, it's ageism in workplaces. And most people 55 plus have experienced it. And negative stereotypes lead to negative behaviours. 1 in 10 business respondents have an age limit above which they won't recruit. And that age is 50. So quite a few of us would be cooked if that was the case. And older workers are much more likely to be made redundant, less likely to be promoted, regarded as harder to train with new ways of doing things, and are regarded less technologically savvy. So these attitudes, this is new research, it's young people are the worst in this regard. Again, some education, I think, is really at the heart of it. So I guess the challenge is we have an ageing population and workforce. I mean, the Chinese workforce is already starting to decline. I think your comment, Bob, was quite interesting. It's already on the decline in China. The Japanese workforce is well and truly on the decline. They're going to lose 20% of their workforce in the next 25 years, or their population in the next 25 years. Can you imagine that? You've got a whole economy geared up for 20% more people. It's like a dying river. but we face substantial gaps in our retirement income base, and a lot of that's because of poor education and people making bad choices. And we have entrenched negative community attitudes to ageism, usually and most commonly held by young people and very young people. So I think it's very important. From business point of view, we've been around this. When I was head of AI Group, I participated in so many conferences bringing up best practice, companies like Bunnings who do it really well in Australia, Carnival, some of the banks. There's been endless reports, the Law Reform Commission, Emerald Crompton's recent report. We all know really what has to happen. There have been important policy breakthroughs from the 1st of July this year. When you're over 70, your super is payable. You can request part-time work. So these are important legislative changes that give rights to, and that right to request is over 55, not over 70. So that issue of not being able to care for your parents, you can care for your parents, all right. You can say, I've got elderly parents. I want to work 2 days a week, 3 days a week, because I want to spend time with them. Your employer cannot reasonably not accept and allow you to do that. So the law is moving, I think, ahead of community opinions and businesses. Business fights, I was on that. I would say this is a terrible thing, it's going to cost business. But in the end, business will get its head around it and accept it. And I think it's important that people feel comfortable making those choices, just as a mother coming back from having a baby has that right to request an extra year's unpaid leave as well. And we need to get our head in those sorts of spaces. AI Group produced a terrific toolkit to help business deal with ageing workforce, and the development of the business case, how you put that together. A self-assessment tool on your culture, the culture of the company. How good are you at it? Do you really know what's going on in the attitudes in your company? How to recruit older workers. How to recruit them, how to go take them through it, how to retrain them, including mentoring, training, restructuring workplaces, and the provision, of course, of flexible work, and a guide to health and safety. And it's a very practical guide, really beaut thing, but we don't sell many copies. In fact, we give them away, but we don't give away as many copies, I think, as we should. So, in conclusion, I think my perspective on this, from very many perspectives, it's a big economic public policy issue, but it's a very big issue for individuals. And in the end, we're not a nanny society. Individuals have to make their own choice. Australia's got a wonderfully robust safety net, and above that, we all need to get on with it and contribute. Retiring early is bad. Retiring with poor information's worse. So I think education and funds like AustralianSuper very much have to be part of that. Business needs to be in the game, but individuals need to know their rights and agitate for them. And I think then we need to get on with it. Rather than just have these endless inquiries around the issue, we need to get on with it. So thank you.
Oh, sorry. Thanks very much, Heather. It's interesting, to hear some of those figures about discrimination in this day and age. It's really quite frightening. There's a lot to learn from the pockets of best practice that are going on out there. I know that McDonald's led a targeted selection and hiring practice in the US to hire people older than 55. Doesn't sound that old to me, but anyway. And they found that, the typical 16-year-old high school student in the McDonald's restaurants were quite fickle. They didn't serve the customer correctly. They didn't follow the safety and hygiene practices and so on. And McDonald's have had outstanding results in terms of reliability, in terms of productivity, customer service, etc., with this hiring practice. And I believe that they're now trialling it out in Tarrant Point McDonald's in Sydney. I think the real challenge will be how to integrate the workforce with the younger workers and the older workers going on. So look forward to reading more about this. So our next speaker, it's a pleasure to introduce Mike Sherris. He's a professor and head of school in actuarial studies at the Australian School of Business. His research is published in leading academic journals, which have been recognised with numerous international and national awards. And prior to academic life, Mike worked in the banking and financial industry for a number of banks and insurance companies. And he's here today to talk about how do we integrate a lot of these issues. So please join me in welcoming Mike.
Thanks, Julie. So I have a slide, and just to set what I'm going to say in context. I'm going to talk a little bit about the finance and insurance mechanisms that we use to fund life and retirement, including retirement, some of the issues around that. And of course, what we face is quite a complex environment, and people have to make complex decisions. We hear a lot about this, and people have trouble doing that. So I'm going to talk a little bit about changing markets, changing risks, and product issues around not only really financing retirement, but financing health, and also looking at savings and the change from savings to retirement and drawing down of savings in retirement. And some of the ways or challenges and opportunities that come from that. And some of the opportunities come from the type of research that has been carried out in CEPAR. Some of the complexity that people face in decision making gets addressed in the type of research that's been presented at this conference over the last few days. But it's very complicated to transfer that easily to individuals so they understand it. So I'll talk a little bit about how technology might do that. So maybe we need the Raku app for the research that we do here and translating that into decision making for individuals. So if we have a look at the environment, and this has been happening for a long time, we've seen changing markets in terms of the types of products that people can invest in, the types of assets. If you go back 100 years ago, we had fairly basic assets. We now have well-developed derivative markets. We have CDOs and all sorts of fancy instruments that people do invest in and can come unstuck. And we've seen the aging of the population, so we're moving away from savings and accumulation now to more drawdown of savings. So that has implications for financial markets and the impact on financial markets and the types of products that people may want in terms of income streams versus exposure to risk. Insurance markets shifting from life and income protection to providing some sort of longevity, and we've struggled to do that. We don't have the products. We have companies that are trying to innovate in that area that provide you with the longevity protection. We have drawdown products, but in terms of the risk of living long and outliving your savings, we can pool some of that risk. We have innovative ways to pool certain aspects of that risk and manage that risk, but that they're not being used and implemented. And some of the research we've done at CEPAR and other people around the world, NetSpar, can inform that debate. And housing markets, we know that one of the biggest assets that individuals have and going into retirement is their house. They want to live in their house, want to age in their house, but you know, what are the issues around downsizing? How does housing help finance retirement or living longer? Equity release products, how do they fit into the product suite? How do you actually get a well-designed financial plan that brings these things together that is communicatable to individuals? And we had changing risks, because when people died early and they weren't faced with the health risks that we may face in older age, we haven't had to worry about health and long-term care. So health risks become much more predominant as we age. We have to understand them better. And we know that individuals vary in their health characteristics. You get to 65, not everybody at 65 has the same health characteristics. But do the products that we offer, does the type of advice that we provide to individuals take that into account? And generally not. Do we have tools that allow people to take into account possible health outcomes and how that might impact their drawdown or savings in terms of retirement? Changes in non-life insurance aspects. We have home insurance, now we obviously need that, but think about auto insurance, the risks that people face when driving as they get older. These are changing. They'll change the way that non-life insurers look at their business as the types of policyholders they have age. And then there may be issues around designing contracts that better suit older individuals. And life insurance, we're moving from these savings products and hopefully into longevity-related products. So in terms of the challenges and opportunities, I thought just before I prepared this a little bit about, if you went back 40 years and you had a look at the types of technology and tools we had available. So if you had a financial calculator that was programmable, this was state of the art in those days, it didn't do very much. It couldn't compute that much, and it was very complicated to use. Right, to program it up, you had to be like a nerdy actuarial student, like I was. And then the alternative was large mainframes. And once again, they didn't do a lot of computation, accounting type stuff, but they were difficult to use and program. You had to punch cards and worry about trying to get the thing to run. So we had very simple applications, but very complicated ways of using those simple applications. And even when the first PC came along, the desktop PC, it was very hard to use. If you wanted to do anything effective, you had to understand the operating system, you had to understand where different programs sat, you had to understand how it all worked if you wanted to use it effectively. And then the spreadsheets you might use were very simplistic. Everything was very simplistic, but very complicated to use. Now, step forward to today and look at our iPhones, our desktops. We have massively complex programs running, doing massively powerful things and very easy to use. We just tap on the screen, right? We bring up a box and we put in some numbers. The interface is very easy. It's the Raku of information technology. There's an app for this, there's an app for that. But then you have a look at making financial decisions. Some of the insurance companies have some application type things on their website. For the average person in the street, probably fairly difficult to use. It's not like an app where you can push on buttons and look at alternatives and so on. It doesn't integrate different risks. It may look just at the particular product the service provider is providing. So what I think some of the opportunities and challenges come from is taking some of the research around the risks and how to make decisions about that and putting that into your Raku app for retirement, and making it user-friendly in terms of being able to look at different risks and how those risks could be managed through different products. It might be a challenge in terms of doing that, but I think if you have a look at what's happened with technology, it's perfectly possible. We should perfectly be able to do it. And so that kind of brings me to wrapping up the sorts of things that I wanted to say. If you do look at financial products out there, a lot of them are, on the face of it, complex. Individuals tell us that when they look at these products, they have difficulty making decisions about these products, even simple life annuity products. So when we do develop products, we need simplicity, even though underlying the product may be complexity. So these variable annuities with guarantees of long life income and so on, they need careful management, of course, but they have attractions to individuals, but they may be complex underneath, but they need to be relatively simple in the way they're presented and understood in terms of meeting individual needs. Flexibility and ease of understanding, lower costs with optional extras, so basically people they get frightened away by some of the costs of some of these financial products, so designing something that's efficient in terms of the way it's offered and managed and having lower costs is important. And also, obviously, financial advice very important, and trust is also very important. But the main thing I wanted to stress was that there are challenges. We've got a very complex financial environment. There are very complex decisions to be made by individuals. But there are opportunities. We have technology that can convert what we know from research and other ideas from business and so on into something that can be used by individuals. We have very complicated things that go on computers, applications that are easy to use and they are useful. And I think we can do that in this area. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mike. Now it's over to you. This is an opportunity to ask a question of the panel. Hands up for questions. Great, thank you. At the front.
Thank you. Peter Scully from One Focus. What concerns me is we have a banking system that encourages our young people to negatively gear their house purchases, when we've got evidence that this is not in their best interest and the impacts are cumulative through their lifetime. So it seems that our larger institutions lack the, they might state they have a social prerogative in some of their policy decision making, but their actual behaviour and products and the way they're producing them to people who don't have the literacy is very dangerous. Mm-hmm. What can be done about that?
Are you able to take that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the primary issue for me is, again, it's probably a bit of a communication issue for me, because in a sense, what a financial institution is doing is selling money on a margin. And that's what they're doing. Some people sell biscuits, some people sell hamburgers, some people sell money on a margin. And it's very difficult, I think, for a consumer to understand that, particularly I do agree with what you're saying, when the bank says, you know, you can borrow, I've got three young adult kids who are kind of in the world you're talking about, you know, they're sort of muttering and mumbling about first jobs and borrowing money and buying houses and stuff, and I'm actually pretty cool with all this. But I'm always fascinated when they come back and the bank says, you can borrow this much. I was doing this with my son last night. He's an economist, so he gets the numbers. But I was saying, but what if rates go up 3%? To which he says, oh, Dad, that couldn't happen. And I go, oh, Jesus, son. Oh, Lord, oh, sure, Lord. So I take him back. Listen, son, in January 1980, your mum and I were paying 18.75%. And he said, oh, yeah, but Dad, there wasn't electricity back then. And, you know. Yeah. So, you know. Yeah. You've got the same problem, Heather. So the issue is that in a sense, if you start to re-regulate, what I'm frightened about is the response that myself and Vicky got from a bank as a young couple with a reasonable deposit and reasonable future. Is the bank that day should have lent us the money. And in a sense, if you like, you could argue they may have, let's say the world turned to crap. Well, maybe the bank saying no was the right thing to do. But for mine, I actually would disagree a little with you on the negative gearing issue. Now, 2 points, and I'll try and be quick. Number one, as part of Paul Clitheroe's political party, and I agree here with the work in the Henry Report, negative gearing is gone. Not because I don't believe in negative gearing. I'd actually like to see money going into more productive assets than property. Negative gearing. So one thing you could do is, so I'm at a philosophical level, I would rather all Australians got some tax relief, as happens in every other first world country, to own one home. What I don't like, first of all, politically and philosophically, I don't agree with a system which says don't ever live in the home you own until it's paid off, but own 42 properties that are negatively geared. I disagree a little on negative gearing, but let's put that aside. What we're talking about here is what regulation, what set of rules do we want around our banks about what they do and can't do? Personally, I prefer the free market within reason. I do, obviously, at the end of the day, do agree with the new consumer credit code. Bluntly, I'm far more worried about young Australians and the $42 odd billion in credit card debt. I'm worried about the average young Australian having $2,500 and so on. So for mine, and I'm not sure what the rest of the panel think about this, but for mine, I still think that consumer knowledge, allowing younger Australians to make a choice, is probably going to be more powerful than trying to draw up a set of rules which says, bank, you can do this, you can't do that. Because if we end up getting back to the day where the bank says to someone like Paul and Vicky, we're not lending you any money at all because you might get pregnant, that actually isn't a step forward. What do you think, Heather? I mean, it's a challenging area. But personally, I'm a free marketeer. Reasonable regulations and give the consumer knowledge.
Well, I mean, I think Australia's pretty lucky. We've got a strong banking system and it served us very well through the GFC. We've got four of the 9 AAA or AA rated banks in the world. So, and that's because they're well supervised and have done prudent things over time. I agree. I mean, John and I, when we did that big report on the tax system, we had a view about negative gearing and that it should be reviewed and it should be harmonised. I know what you're saying. I know,
no,
but I'm talking about negative gearing.
Because you're talking about something totally different to the question.
You're talking about...
I was talking about negative gearing, not related to a rental property. I was talking about the fact that with rates, maintenance and insurance on the structure, together with interest, that totaled more than the rental value of the property acquired.
Right, not the tax
at all.
Yeah.
Oh. That's what I meant by negative.
Right. Well,
they're the same thing. Yeah. One has a tax consequence, one doesn't.
Correct.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay?
Yep.
So it's specifically where people are being encouraged by the system to go into a housing decision with too small a deposit, too early, and the cumulative cost is unbelievable, so they're totally dependent or praying for price appreciation in the house to get their nose in front.
It's not much different than negative gearing. Capital appreciation is what gets you over the line over time.
But there's no capital appreciation, there's price appreciation.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
and the evidence shows that.
Yeah. So do you have a specific question?
Well, I had the specific question. How do you stop the banks
I wouldn't. You have to make buyer beware. Yeah. You know?
I wouldn't.
No, I wouldn't either.
So I don't.
So
you
think
can.
The panel's
I don't. You can.
In favour of free market.
Think, yeah.
Do we have another question? Just the lady over here. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Do we have to contemplate some other risks that are not necessarily directly financial? In August, I think this year, we're going to have the first Australian seminar on centenarians in Canberra. This conference has been on a lot about having a long life, but you know, have we really thought about that? Becoming a parent again in middle and late life with drug issues where parents have to take over the care of children, which was completely unexpected and for which they have not planned. Being diagnosed with Alzheimer's, often coming quite late in life. Now, Peter Taylor Gooby has written quite an interesting book about the new risks of an ageing society. I think our looking at risks is somehow very narrow. We're actually not looking at some of the frontline risks of, you know, losing one's job because you just simply don't have the skills to be re-employable. And I know a lot of people on the panel do know about that. But we do have to think about what are the other safety nets and collective responsibilities for unanticipated risks, even with the best actuarial advice.
Who wants to take that? I mean, I think that's a relevant issue. We look at the prevalence of grandparents taking a leading role in the upbringing of their grandchildren. I mean, there was it's amazing sort of statistics that I've seen. Does anyone on the panel want to address that one, the other risks?
I'm good on health risks.
Yeah, I'd just say that I totally agree with you. There are a lot of risks, some of them you've identified, some you don't identify, and I mean, how do you manage those? We have government schemes that somehow manage some of those, but otherwise we have to rely on our own personal savings, so you can't necessarily annuitise all your wealth because you won't have a buffer if you don't have some government scheme that manages that. So there is a lot of uncertainty, but we have to think about trying to identify those risks and understand, do they impact, you know, 50% of the population or 5% of the population? How important is that risk in terms of its impact? And if it's large, then we have to address it in terms of either individuals are going to be responsible for it, or that we have to, as a community, recognise it affects a lot of people and we have to fund it at a government level. But they're the kinds of things you need to think about. But you're right, there's always going to be another risk around the corner. It's a question of how important it's going to be and how we actually manage that.
I mean, I don't think we're even that good at managing some of the known things. You know, like with a pensioner, cash poor, with a big house, can't repair it, so it's falling down around them. And I mean, there is money people can access. Again, it's not readily understood all the time. Frankly, they should sell that house and move into somewhere else, but the family, oh no, don't sell the house, you're getting the full pension, it's not part of the assets test. So, you know, and then your fat payer, you know, a transaction cost to a stamp duty to buy, you know, all these, we're not even good at doing some of the basics, let alone some of these modern things that are coming there. But I mean, I think government is pretty conscious of the fact that there are people in hardship and, you know, there are schemes. But, you know, it's really going to be much more, I think, part of the scheme of things.
Just on that point, I think one of the real risks that we haven't covered is people losing their job, over 50, over 55. And given some of the data that Heather presented around discrimination of this age, okay, it may not be legal, and okay, we've got policies that you've got to be flexible, still doesn't stop that it's happening.
Well,
Heather, do you want to?
The third reason after financial and health is redundancy, that people retire early for the third most stated reason. And, you know, we've had, for example, in the late 80s and 90s when we had the big shakeout in manufacturing, something like 150,000 people went into disability pensions and they stayed there a long time because the disability pension is not an allowance to get you from A to B, it's you can live on it. And these are big things when we're having restructuring going on in our economy, how we deal with this stuff. And we're going through one of those at the moment, you know, how. And the construct of our system is that you have a pension, which is an old age pension or a disability pension that you can live on. You're not expected to work again. It's indexed at a rate, average weekly earnings, so you get to grow with the government, the nation's productive capacity. So you get a benefit. The allowances, New Start stuff, that's to tide you over in between jobs. So, you know, it's tough. And then there's the youth allowance, etc. But that issue between pension and allowances is a huge one. But how people manage this redundancy issue is very important. We've had terrific examples like when Mitsubishi closed down in South Australia. Virtually everyone who wanted to find a job has found another spot. But a lot of people went fishing, and because they were over 55. And I reckon they're probably part of that 230,000 are now searching around for something to do. So it is a really live issue. And in Australia, where we're seeing the transition of our economy into a new space, the well-paid jobs of manufacturing are under real pressure, the dollar, et cetera. And it's alive and well. And you even look in retail. When the dollar went high and stayed there, all the gurus said, well, that old industry like manufacturing, it'll be the one caught up in all this. But it ended up retailing, tourism, you name it, communication, media, everybody in Australia, all these sectors are caught up in this structural change, which has been turbocharged. Our future's been fast-forwarded by having this currency at parity for a couple of years. And so it's a live question. And redundancy pay might last you 3-6 months, then you're there. So. Big issue.
And I think, John brought out the issue in the earlier session about what do you do when a CEO retires? It's an all or nothing type of situation for them. Mm. But it's not just the CEO. It's other people who are looking at retirement but probably don't want to work full time. So what sort of arrangements can be put in place so that we still are able to draw on the expertise for that group of people?
I think big companies are doing this much better, much, much better. But the vast bulk of Australians don't work in big companies, they work in little companies. And when the boss has to let them go, and I sort of had an argument about this, but these redundancy issues for small companies are quite fraught. But the big end of town, they get it, they're shamed if they don't do it properly, governments will walk all over them, the unions will walk all over them, somehow or other they'll get nailed. But a lot of them want to do it properly because they're part of communities. But the vast bulk in the small business area, you lose your job and you just walk out the door and get a month's pay. Mm.
Okay, thanks, Heather. Another question? Yes, down the back in the red tie.
Longevity. David Williams. Hi, Paul. I was at uni at both these universities before both of you.
I think you were, David Williams.
I think I was, yes, Paul. it seems to me, I'll get back to one of my pet themes, but I think we've got a really excellent program on literacy and dealing with literacy risk in the community. I don't believe we've got any substantial program for dealing with longevity risk at the community level. Mm-hmm. And I think it's really up to industry and employers to get their socks on and get out and run on this problem. Because we do understand longevity risk pretty well. We're learning all the time. We understand the metric of it. Mm. We understand the nature of it. We know that as people get older, their exposure to longevity risk, in fact, widens across the community because we all have different capabilities as we age. And the range of capabilities is wider. But I'm yet to see anybody in industry introduce this notion at, say, age 45 to 50. This is when the critical time is for getting on top of longevity risk, not at 65. I don't use retirement anymore, I haven't for years. But it's not at age 65, it's age 45 to 50. We've got to get the rubber on the road. And I think industries will prepare themselves if they train their senior managers and staff to understand longevity risk at a much earlier stage and begin to get it into the culture. And I think it's a huge opportunity to start doing it now. And the longer we wait, the harder it's going to be, because the numbers simply overpower us. So I'd like to get some feedback on that. Is that realistic?
I got to pull you up on one thing. Could I get you to start using the word longevity opportunity?
Yeah.
Not longevity risk.
Paul, my website is called My Longevity, okay. Not My Longevity Risk.
It's a longevity opportunity, okay?
Yeah. But if we've got to scare businessmen into action, we've got to talk about the risk first.
Sure.
But I agree with you totally.
We need to be careful about internal speak, and we need to be careful about what we're communicating. So internally, I think longevity risk is smart, because what we're doing here is we're thinking about all the bad stuff.
I think that's really important. You know, this is terrible, but when we're talking to people, I think you'll find, and whether I'm talking to business or individual consumers in the world of financial literacy, I feel very strongly that this actually, for me personally and you, David Williams, this is an opportunity. And yes, the opportunity of living longer brings all sorts of risks. And people in these our organisations, we do need to talk about it. But look, it's a bit like the question before you about, you know, a conference of, you know, about Australians aged 100 plus. I think we've got to be, you know, a little realistic in a sense, because I think in my view, the research is always going to be the leader. So in a sense, this group, there are no more knowledgeable group of people than there are sitting right here today. And for me, this is where it starts. I think we're probably all impatient in the sense, say, for example, would we as a group of people who understand this love to see a government policy about what do we do for all the Australians aged above 100 years old? And we'd love to see it, but it ain't going to happen right now. Because, you know, right now there are a bunch of other pressing problems, and I feel policy evolves based on the facts. And I think our role here is to establish facts, communicate facts, take it to universities, which we are, to industry, eventually it will get to government. I personally don't see government as much of a leader, to be quite honest with you. I think the government ends up being a follower based, this is the starting point for policy that will come. Mm. So I'm not that stressed about it right now.
But I mean, I think if you're talking about longevity as in people living, say, beyond 80 and having much different needs and their money runs out and having to get a longevity insurance arrangement going, I mean, we certainly considered that, John, didn't we, in the Henry stuff. But it's a very hard industry to get going, and it's proving to be. But, you know, I think also, I mean, Australia, we shouldn't be too critical. We've done pretty well to get our SG system going and create this third pillar. And when you wander around, you know, these defined benefit arrangements that exist in Europe and in Canada and stuff, I mean, we've got a defined contribution scheme, and it's pretty good, and it's going to get better. And I think it serves Australia incredibly well. Now, you have to realise that people who are putting money into this, they're foregoing present consumption. Now, it might be all right if you're earning a couple of hundred thousand a year, but if you're working in a simple job earning average weekly earnings, 55,000, you're doing with that 12% of money that you could probably do with a lot now. And the effective marginal tax rate of that is very, very high, very, very high. They don't know it. I think if people knew it, they would never put their money into super if they had a choice. So I think, you know, to try and then add more onto it, I think it's very hard. Employers bucking at the 12%, especially the last three, because I see the incidence is falling squarely on them. You know, can argue about the other nine. I think how we manage this whole thing going forward is important. Can I also say something controversial? I said to John Howard a number of years ago when he was still Prime Minister, and he was looking at doing a whole lot of stuff around the age pension and putting in seniors cards and, you know, really increasing a lot of allowances. And I said to him, you better get be aware of what you're doing in this ageing population. And if you want to make some changes before the grey guys, we get control of the ballot box, you better make them now. And I think in a way, the over 55s are going to have to realise that the cost of supporting our population is going to be so high that, you know, that a senior card for everyone over whatever it is, 55 or 60, is a crazy thing. 80% of people who travel on our country trains are concession holders. How do you run a competitive train system like that? They don't all need it. So somehow we're going to have to get rational about saying, okay, we're going to support old people, you know, make sure people have got good health care, you know, can do what they want to do, but, you know, we don't have to have the Rolls-Royce system around some of those things. We should be willing to trade off. And but at the moment, I think the political debate in Australia is quite pathetic about that. Yes. We want more, but we won't give up anything else to try and make it happen and make it work. And unless we grow the cake quite strongly, and then we appropriate all of that to that, and we've got kids to educate and a whole lot of other things to do, you know, we've only got so many choices. So I think it's got to be a really mature debate, understanding where everyone fits into the system. And individuals are paying a lot, you know, and we all have a lot of needs. So it's a hard one.
And if the poor Clitheroe party gets in, we're all going to be paying more GST.
Actually, I call it the Normal People's
you
Party.
Stuff,
I've been threatening to set up the Normal People's Party for quite a long time because we haven't had one in Australia for a long time. So
Thank you. The
NMP.
We've got a question down the front here with John.
Yeah, hi, John Beard. I've got a question. Whose responsibility is all this? Is it the individual? Is it government? Is it the family? Because underpinning a lot of the things that people are talking about, there are assumptions, and And it's a legitimate question. I don't have an answer. I get asked it all the time, but I'd be interested in the panel's view. And I mean, for example, helping an older person retain their home also enables them to transfer it to the next generation. But is that something government should be subsidising? I mean, I think these are really interesting questions, and I'd be interested in your comments.
So John, is it an or an and?
Yeah, well, okay.
Does anyone want to respond?
Well, I'm happy to start. I think it's a shared responsibility. That might be a cop-out, but I do think it's a shared responsibility. I think government has a role to provide services, a strong safety net of services, and for those to be responsive to the circumstances of individuals. I think that safety net should grow as our economy becomes more prosperous. And so I think all those things are important. It's about the welfare system, about the health system, all those issues. But then I think individuals have a huge role, and they can't blame the government when they make bad choices about investments or whatever, unless the government hasn't properly regulated the industry. And I think we've seen some tightening up of financial planners in Australia, et cetera, in recent times. And I think that's a good thing, so that people can go into these things with their eyes wide open. So to me, it's a shared responsibility. In terms of the family home, et cetera, I really think we need an integrated assets test in Australia, and we should have done it ages ago. But there's a lot of, my point before, too many vested interests with their hands all over this stuff. And whether, you know, I want to come back as one of my children. I think they've had a pretty good go of it. And if I need my family home to be cashed in so that I can live to 150, well, so be it. And we all want to do the right thing by our children, and I think we all do. But I don't think having an asset rich and a person living in poverty because of this home issue is just silly.
Yeah, by the way, Heather, if you do live to 150, you'll be passing money to your 130-year-old children, so they won't be that grateful anyway. But maybe I'll give you an example in what we're trying to do. So, for example, as in, because I represent, because the Howard thing rolled on, it's quite ironic, really, because after the government change, Kevin Rudd reappointed me to do the financial literacy stuff, and then Julia Gillard reappointed me, and now Kevin's back. I got a note the other day, but as I pointed out, Kevin, look, you appointed me for 3 years, and we haven't run out of the 3 years you've been. So the good thing is, it isn't a political issue, is the good thing. So that's important. If financial literacy is a political whim thing, I think we've got a problem. So the challenge for me sits in my own little area, but maybe it's trying to help a little bit, is the, do we regulate or do we educate? And I'd love to talk to the gentleman with a question about the negative gearing over a cuppa. I'd love to know more about that. But for me, it is quite interesting. So with my OECD hat on, I was in London recently, and I was the other side of a debate with a bunch of PhDs in British Treasury who were arguing that financial literacy is the cause of the global financial crisis. And it's good subject matter. I love this stuff. I love a good debate. And I'm happy to say I don't know. But basically, their premise was, look, it's idiots like you, because 100 countries worldwide are pushing very hard in financial literacy. And basically, they're saying, look, it's idiots like you are pointing at me, that gave people a modicum of knowledge, and a modicum of knowledge is a dangerous thing. And I think we'd all, in other words, they became more confident. They maybe took on too much gearing or whatever it may be, Storm Financial. Maybe it was financial literacy's fault, was the point of the debate. And so what we're talking, fine, let's assume for a second that knowledge is bad, which I personally struggle with. But let's assume that, let's assume we won't do any education whatsoever. We will regulate everything. So how do we regulate consumers to be safe, to live a long life, to generate money, not to get ripped off, you know, not to buy the couch at the local furniture store on a pay no interest for 500 years and then realise you're on a 36% consumer finance contract. They say, how do you do that without, the credit code is trying hard to regulate much better institutional behaviour. Particularly around the most expensive forms of debt, you know, which are obviously that sort of 32, 36% stuff. So, you know, my response keeps going back to, and like Heather, I don't think it's fence sitting. I think if it's all government and all regulation, we are the government, we're here to protect you, we will regulate you from everything to ensure you live a great life, I think we're stuffed. Mm. But on the other hand, how much knowledge in this complicated world, how much knowledge can we realistically expect any consumer to have about possibly living to 100? I mean, I'm challenged enough about if I'm going to live longer. I mean, it was only 30-odd years ago that, you know, I'd probably cark it at 69 or something. The kids get the money, they buy a house. Why worry about housing? But if in actual fact the death clock is right and I'm going to live to 91, a challenging issue for myself and Vicky is, well, bloody hell, the kids will be 70. Mm-hmm. So at what point do we Now, can the government tell me what to do in those areas? No, thank you. So I don't believe I'm fence sitting. Where I'm struggling, though, is I'm struggling. Some areas are pretty damn obvious. If we want people to, I'll repeat myself quickly. If we want people to actually not use banks that are foreign banks and pay $2, a really smart thing is not to try and educate them. Simply get the force, the banking system, to have a button where you've got to press $2 to a button to donate $2 to the bank. I think the credit code where institutions can't flog ridiculous amounts of credit on people at 18 and 23%, I think that's good regulation. Mm. So what I'm a bit sure about, though, is there's an awfully big blurry area in my mind between what's your responsibility. You know, what should you do about your house, your aging parents, your children, how much money do you need, how long should you work, do you need to reskill? I think the day anyone's dictating to you about that, I think we've lost the plot. But I think what we're saying is some things we clearly regulate. In my opinion, some things we clearly educate, which is what we're talking about here today in my view, but at the moment there's an awfully big grey bit in the middle and the world is changing so fast. I think probably you're right, Michael, that, you know, will there soon be apps that allow me to make, you know, we'd love this in the world of financial literacy. You know, is there something that allows me to help me make better decisions personally? And that's the bit I'm struggling with. It's a really challenging question. Some things I can see we clearly regulate. Criminals should be in jail. Okay, I kind of get that. But basically, some things we should have knowledge about, but there's a dirty, great big bit in the middle that people like us should debate about, and it should fall into either regulation, education, or possibly a bit of both. I don't yet know.
Well, the purpose of regulation is really to risk shift. That's all it is. So, you know, that's what governments do, and they, of course, do good things with it, and they do bad things with it. I think one of the things that's going to happen, though, you know, just from AustralianSuper's perspective, you know, our emphasis has really been on the accumulation phase, so helping people, you know, get their money, get their super organised, work out how best to do it, what investment choice to make. And I think we're now focusing much more on the decumulation side, and I think a lot of funds are thinking much more around that. And I think that's going to be because of the more people are in it and going to be in it, and there's more demand for it. And there'll be options, I think, which will give people a lot more security, and they'll know what they're getting. And, you know, even though people do exercise choice, the vast bulk of people going to the balance funds advocated, or, you know, by the fund, by their employer, or by the fund.
No, look, at a moment of genius years ago, I'd quite regularly on the Money Show given, you know, here are three pretty good shares, here are three pretty good superannuation funds. The next day, the switchboard at Channel 9 melts down with people saying, ah, yes, but which of the three do I choose? It's a bloody complicated world.
I think the industry will start to find a My Pension option, which might be My Pension Plus option that I love. But, you know, I think something like that there'll be options there which will give people a bit more confidence. If they want to take risks, depending on their risk appetite, well, you know, beside making sure that basic regulation's right, I think people have got to make their own choices.
Sure.
Well, time for just one more question.
How do you see not only longevity opportunities, but also empowering people with their money and seeing it as an opportunity to gain information from a financial planner as a positive as opposed to just a product flog or something? How do you encourage that, or how do you see things growing in that industry?
Yeah, it's a classic case, and this is where regulation is a good thing. I'm a huge supporter of the FOFA regulations, which started on July 1. And the reason I'm a huge supporter is that you can try and come up with 8 million different rules. I mean, that's why our Tax Act has gone from being this big to about 14 shipping containers. So I guess a glib answer is, I think a financial planner who's really, really well qualified and used to charging fees and smart, the answer would be highly profitable. That's why, for example, I'm not selling my bank shares in a hurry, by the way. I think there's going to be all sorts of opportunities. But if we come back to a consumer level, the thing that's been most lacking in my view in financial advice is, and for me, a summary of great financial advice is, we'll be winning when the day when someone walks into a financial advisor, financial planner, and the financial planner looks at them and says, you know, the best thing you can do right now is put extra money into your mortgage. Then we know we're winning, because the only way that a financial planner can give that advice is like a lawyer or accountant, is that, you know, you ring me up, I explain what my hourly fees are, and if you want to come and have a half-hour chat, it might cost you a few dollars, But basically, at the end of the day, I'm really keen on the covering line of FOFA, which is, and it will enshrine this in legislation, is a planner must act in the best interest of the client. Mm. Whereas the reality is, and there's no point shying away from this, for most parts of history, I think good planners have always been good planners, by the way, and there's always been some out there. They're growing in number. But the reality is, most times, a lot of Australians have not got the advice they needed because the planner has said, hell, if I don't actually sell you something, I don't pay off my mortgage and feed my family. And that is a fundamental underlying context. And I guess the consumer's going to have a terrible shock as well, by the way, because I had someone ringing me on radio the other day saying, oh, this FOFA is terrible. And I said, look, I'm glad you even know what the words are. This is fantastic. Why is it terrible? He said, oh, now I'm going to need to pay for advice. And I said, well, what do you think was happening to you before, for God's sake? And he said, oh, I wasn't paying. I said, well, you damn well were paying. I mean, you go back to some of the old insurance company products, you know, the $20 savings plan, you know, what I call a transfer of wealth product, where your money is stolen and divided between the insurance company and the salesman. You know, thank heavens for this sort of stuff. So I'm really excited about this concept of Simply, and it's such, rather than 82,000 rules, you must act in the best interest of your client, full stop. And it's really a lot of less qualified financial planners, and a lot of financial planners used to flog and stuff, are going to quit the industry very quickly.
Yeah.
And good riddance.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry, we do need to wrap it up there. We've obviously made a lot of progress in this issue as captured by this panel and the previous speakers, but still a long way to go. So please join me in thanking Paul, Heather, Bob and Mike.